Now that we finished the cleaning, it's time for some dodge and burn. Dodge and burn is the technique that allows you to manipulate light and shadows in order to fix the lighting on your scene. Before we start diving in on the dodge and burn techniques, I would like to bring some of the tools that I'm gonna be using for us to visualize our files, and you're gonna see that this type of tool is gonna help you moving forward. So let me just bring the file here. This is called visualizations, and the first thing that I want to show you guys, it's called the film grain. The film grain, it's a noise that you can add on your background. Usually you add over the whole image to kind of tighten it up, everything together as far as texture goes, because as you can see here, this is at 100%, so you can see that this is very strong here. We don't wanna, film grain, you have to be a little careful. You cannot do too much, and you cannot do too little. So you kinda have to find that balance where you can tie everything together and still make it work and still make it look good. And then you ask me like, but Hugo, how am I gonna do that? I got you, don't worry. So when you come here, usually you put this in overlay, and I usually use around 60, 70%, depending on the job. But don't take this as a rule. Sometimes you're working with photos that has a high ISO, that has a lot of noise, and sometimes to compensate, you need to add a little more. So in some cases, you need to be a little more aggressive. Some cases you need to be a little more cautious. So take it case by case, but I think what I explained here, it gives you a nice baseline for you to start experimenting yourself in your images and creating better results, okay? Now that we covered the film grain, we're gonna look at the other visualizations here, and we're gonna start with the crazy curve. The crazy curve, as you can see, it makes the image look crazy, but it allows you to kind of identify any problems that you have in your image as far as gradiency or any other small imperfections you have that are not very apparent to the naked eye. For example, there's some lenses that are a little dirty, but they don't show as much on the file, and you're able to see that. You're able to find always any small imperfections. But as you can see here, our gradient look nice, and our shoe, even looking a little psychedelic, but still looks nice. So we're good here. And then we have the famous, most famous of all, check your contrast, black and white. You can do putting a gray layer in color, or you can do a hue saturation and just pull all the way the saturation to minus 100. You get the same result. And this is the most relevant one for this specific exercise about the dodge and burn. Why? Because we're talking about values. We're talking about lighting and shadow. And as I explained in the beginning of the video, dodge and burn is the skill to manipulate light and darkness, or highlights and shadows, in order to create a smooth transition between these values while valuing the shapes of your product, or your shoe, or your skin, because dodge and burn is a technique that you can use in any single image you produce, because it's a technique that is easy to be adapted to any type of images you do. Cool? The other one, it's the saturation map, and that will allow you to recognize the levels of saturation in your image, and with that, you can sometimes identify things that, because you have been working too long on the image, because you have been diving deep, or because you have it's not the case of this image, for example, because we don't have a crazy amount of colors here. We kind of have just a little bit, and I can easily see here that the orange is kind of like the more saturated color of this scene. But whenever you're doing like a landscape work, a matte painting, like a car driving in the sunset in Hawaii, for example, which is gonna be very colorful, sometimes you need a little assistant to be able to dial back some of these colors. And having this checklist has been helping me a lot during the years. And I think it's a nice gift for you guys to have it and to incorporate on your workflow, because the more you pay attention on the process, the more you care about the process, the more you revise your work while still evolving on the job and still evolving on the project, you're gonna make less mistakes, and that's gonna translate in better images, more detail, equal high end. Okay? So how are you gonna do that? You can do a selective color, which is you can find here on adjustment layers at the bottom. And then once you have the selective color, you're gonna put a normal, and then you're gonna go all your colors, red, yellow, green, cyan, blue, and magenta. You pull -100 at absolute, and then you come to whites and you do +100, +100, +100. Cool? What about the color comparison? Color comparison, it's a visualization that allows you to check all the colors you have in your scene and kind of the intensity. So if you think about it, the color comparison and the saturation map are kind of like cousins, because they kind of do the same thing, but in a different way. You can see that here, you can see that this orange is way more vibrant, and here you get the confirmation of that. So it's, as you can see, like everything that I'm explaining here kind of makes sense when you put everything together. And if you incorporate that on your workflow, like I said, less mistakes. The way you're gonna do this, you grab any color layer, solid color, put in a luminosity blending mode right here, and then you're good to go. And to finalize, I always like to have a little curve going dark, mid-tone, kind of half-tone, not even, like almost half, pulling a little bit of the lighting too, and then that's all. So with these tools, I think it will help you a lot. So let's move forward to the part of the dodge and burn. But before we do that, let me show you how I create this background here, because I don't want you to be all surprised and say, hey Hugo, where this came from? Don't worry, I got you. Let me explain to you real quick. So here we have our background, and to create this background, I'm gonna do a gradient. I'm gonna make sure that this gradient, it's going from white to transparent. So let me just double check here. Transparent, yes. Then I'm gonna grab this color here and do like this. I'm gonna have to go a little lighter, just in case, a little less saturated, a little less saturated, no more. Okay, good. I'm gonna put around 50 degrees. Oh, let me put a detour here because it helps with the gradient a little bit. And now I'm gonna duplicate this. I'm gonna grab this background, this solid color, and I'm just gonna go crazy and just flat it out. And you're like, what? What are you doing, man? Relax. I'm gonna show you, and we're gonna fix the steps. Don't worry. Because usually when you're working, especially when you're working with the gradient tool, it's hard to not have this kind of steps in your gradient. And I'm gonna teach you a way to fix that. But before, we wanna expand this gradient a little bit, because it got a little too much for this. Let me just take a little bit of the saturation. That was a little heavy on the green there. But now, we can go ahead and just do a crazy blur, like 1,000. Because I just wanna blow up these values a little bit, kind of mix it up between the green and the black there. I wanna do that again, just one more time. After that's done, I'm gonna apply some noise. Usually I do 2% first, and then I'll come here, filter, filter gallery, and then we're gonna do the spatter. The spatter, it's almost like a spray of noise all over the terrain or the area that you're applying the spatter. So for example, if you have a gradient and it's all messed up, being like in a layer or being on a mask, you can apply the spatter and it will fix it. Let me show you how it's gonna fix it. So you apply, you can see that you already had a little change here. You can see that the most of the steps here are kind of gone. But just to make sure, I'm gonna apply one more time, because usually I kind of like apply 2 or 3 times max, just to make sure, because I don't think it's necessary to apply more than that. But you can judge for yourself and you can see. Honestly, I feel like this one is kind of good to go. I'll do one more just in case. We are already here, so. Okay, once that's done, I'm gonna apply a little more noise, 1%, and then I'm just gonna do a 0.8 pixel Gaussian blur, and boom. Your gradient, it's fixed, your background looks nice, and you're ready to start your dodging bird. Cool? Now, let's talk about dodge and burn. How are we gonna do it? We already talked about that dodge and burn is the technique that allows you to manipulate light and dark, shadows and highlights in order to create a better flow of lighting in any of the surface of your image, right? So how are we gonna do this? There is many different techniques that people do. There's techniques of putting layer in gray, putting overlay and then painting over. There's other techniques. The technique that I like the most is using curves, because curves, it's a non-destructive adjustment that I can easily control and I can easily apply color if I need to. So it kind of is, it kind of looks like dodging burn on steroids, you know what I mean? Like, because it gives you more control. As far as you evolve in your career and everything, you want to be able to do, to have more control, because we want to kind of adjust everything. And you saw here, like in this class, like how much and how deep we have been going on this file. So it's fair to say that more control, the better, because the more control you have, the more power you have, and it's easier for you to control the outcome of your image. Okay? So how this is gonna work? How this is usually work? I usually have my two layers here, and then I have a halftone pulling up for dodge because I'm gonna make it lighter, and then I have a halftone pulling down because I wanna make it darker. This way, I'm gonna identify these areas on my image that they need some help on the flowing of the lighting, and I'm gonna adjust accordingly so I can have a result that looks amazing and it doesn't create any stranger feelings to my eyes. Like, for example, this area here. Like, we can easily see that something is going wrong here. Like, this should flow in a better way, for example. We can come here and look in our image and we can easily see that this could be a little more refined. It could have a little better flow. Like here, this could flow in a better way. This shape here, we could define it better to give more like a 3D feel, like we were talking before. Remember that everything that we've talked since the beginning, guys, everything's starting to make sense now. It's like you're reading the book and the story starts all messed up, and then by kind of like 3/4 of the book, it's like, oh, now I get it, you know? So it's cool to see that everything that we are planning, everything that we are trying to achieve, we're being able to achieve with our techniques here. Then you can see you could do a little more, a better job here in defining the light and defining this hue. So we're gonna analyze our image here and we're gonna see where we can do this first pass of dodge and burn, because I usually don't do just one pass of dodge and burn. I usually do 2 to 3 passes depending on the image, okay? Nothing, there's no exact rule. It's very subjective, but the technique works. But what I can tell you as a tip is like, we're gonna do the first pass and fix the more glaring areas, right? After that's done, we're gonna come with the lighting adjustments and we're gonna pump it up the contrast of our image. And that's probably gonna mess up a little bit of some areas that then we go back again and do another dodge and burn just to make sure. It's like putting the cherry on the cake, if you know what I mean. So let's start here and let's see how I wanna show you guys some of the things that you have to look for on this type of exercise, especially because this type of exercise, it's also an exercise of patience. You cannot be on a rush when you're gonna do this thing. Unless you're like, you have been training, you're used to, and even then, even like for me, that I'm used to this, like whenever I'm in a rush, like it kind of does, you have to kind of take your time. Even if you're gonna say, hey, I'm gonna spend 45 minutes on this, and that's all I'm gonna do. That's all the time I'm gonna spend. So, okay, so divide in two parts of 22, for example. So you can, because it's nice to take breaks. It's nice to take breaks and look again. This is an exercise of visualization and training your visual perception, because the visual perception is the capacity that the artist has to identify spots that should be fixed that most people cannot see. Why? But you say that? Because we are more trained. We just do this more times. Like I do this every day, in every project I do. So I'm used to. So for me, it's gonna be much easier to identify these areas than, for example, for you guys. So let me show you some tools of visualization that can help you on dodge and burn. We already talked about the black and white, right? That's gonna help you, because sometimes the colors, and on this one, I don't think it's that much of a problem, but for example, sometimes when you're doing skin work and the tones are so close to each other and you have like slight variations, so it's a little harder to see the areas that you need to fix. And of course, with training, with putting in the work, you're gonna see that your visual perception is gonna get better, and you're gonna start seeing stuff that you didn't see before, which is pretty cool, because when that happens, it's the sign that you're really evolving. Another thing that you can do is just increasing the contrast a little bit, maybe pulling an S-curve and just seeing how everything behaves, seeing if you can identify other things that can be fixed, because sometimes when the lighting is too even, it's a little harder to see. And you can also do, you can go a little lighter and a little darker. Again, this is a visual exercise, so you need to test it out, see what works for you, see what fits your project better on any instance, and then apply the best technique from there.